Welcome to this webinar, which is progress and current challenges in online process control for LPBF. I will be your moderator today. I am Madeline. I'll introduce myself later. I am here today with Dr. Yves Hagedorn from Contig3D and Ryan Sommerhuber from Zarian Laser Acoustics.
Hello.
Hello, both of you.
Hi.
Okay, great. Let me just share my screen so you can see the presentation. Great. Okay, well, hello again, everyone. I am just showing you the agenda for this meeting. We're just waiting as everyone is trickling in, and I'll just talk a little bit while we're waiting for everyone to come in. Well, first of all, let me just say thank you for registering. We hope you have a good webinar today. And also to let you all know, we are recording this webinar. So it will be up on YouTube after the presentation. You can access it on 3D Native's YouTube channel, which is which you can find on YouTube. And if you subscribe, you'll be able to be notified when it is put up. So it will be up tomorrow, regardless. So the first bit is the introduction for this webinar, which is what we're doing right now. After that, we are going to move into the presentation, which is process and current challenges in online process monitoring for LPBF. And the last 15 minutes or so will be the Q&A. You are able to ask questions in the Q&A at the bottom. And we do encourage you to write your questions. We will answer them. You can write them at any point. They will be available and we will choose questions. And yeah, okay, let's keep moving. So let's get into it. So to present the webinar itself, we will be talking with Yves and Ryan about process monitoring for laser power bed fusion. As you may or may not know, metal additive manufacturing, or AM, is a quickly growing field that actually, from a report from Technavio from 2020, estimated that the metal AM market will grow by $4.42 billion between 2020 and 2024, representing an annual growth of about 14%. This growth is expected mostly in the automotive sector. Though it has applications in many others, including medical and aerospace. As you might expect, metal AM is popular for similar reasons that popularity is growing in AM in general, notably that it allows manufacturers to reduce costs while still ensuring that the part will be strong and effective. Though there are many different metal AM technologies, for the purpose of this webinar, we will be focusing on laser powder bed fusion. In case you don't know, LPBF, as the name suggests, is part of the powder bed fusion family in AM, where the technologies use a build platform containing powder material to additively manufacture a part. These powders can be polymers or metals, though as we mentioned in this webinar, we will specifically be focusing on metal. In LPBF, a 3D printer fills a chamber with an inert gas, which is then heated up to an optimal printing temperature. A thin layer of powder is then applied to the build platform according to the layer thickness previously defined by the software. The fiber optic laser then scans the cross-section of the part, melting the metal particles together, as you can see in the diagram on the screen. The fiber optic layer scans the cross-section. When the layer is finished, the platform moves down and another layer of powder is added. This process is repeated just until it is finished. This is one of the more popular metal AM methods for, well, all the sectors previously mentioned. This is because it allows for geometric complexity that is impossible to achieve through traditional manufacturing methods. This, in turn, allows manufacturers to reduce the final weight in parts, something that I imagine you can imagine is very useful in sectors such as aerospace and automotive, and the number of components to be assembled. All of this allows for shorter production times and very resistant customized parts. Though one thing that is increasingly being considered in LPBF is how to ensure the quality of these final parts, as this process is being used in industries where parts must not fail, like aerospace, manufacturers want to ensure that there won't be defects. But how can that be accomplished? Well, one way that is gaining in popularity is through process monitoring for AM, which allows users to ensure the quality of the part during the process. Though it is rarely offered, process control significantly reduces errors in printing, which in turn results in much higher quality pieces. Critical for the sectors already mentioned. It's especially important to control the 3D printing processes when working with metal, since it is such an industrial process and one that does not allow for any errors. Today, we will be covering, as I said, progress and current challenges in online process monitoring for LBPF specifically. As I previously stated, my name is Madeline Fryer. I am the English content specialist for 3D Natives, the largest international online media platform on 3D printing, available in four languages, English, of course, but also French, German, and Spanish. I will be the moderator of the panel as well as the Q&A. Once again, reminding everyone that you can ask questions at any point during the presentation, just in the Q&A box on the side. You should be able to see it. And at the end of the Q&A, I will select questions. We will try to get to all of them, but if we don't, we will have some information at the end for how you can get in contact with our speakers if you have further questions. And now let's introduce you to the panelists. First, Dr. Yves Hagedorn is the CEO of Carnoty 3D, a mechanical engineering company for special machines in the field of LPBF that was founded in 2014. His goal is to provide flexible and open equipment technology to efficiently expand metal 3D printing towards industrialization. And from 2009 to 2014, he worked at the Fraunhofer Institute, focusing on high temperature LPBF. Since 2015, he has been, as mentioned, the managing director of the Carnoty 3D GmbH, with a strong focus on extending the current state of the art in laser-based metal additive manufacturing. Next panelist is Ryan Sommerhuber, who is an application engineer at Zarian Laser Acoustics. Zarian developed the world's first and only laser-based microphone, which is used for many laser applications for live process monitoring. The patented idea behind Zarian's technology is to detect sound based on its ability to change the speed of light. This can then be used for acoustic quality monitoring for laser material processing, real-time monitoring of AM processes, and intelligent inline monitoring of production lines and machines. Welcome, gentlemen. Let's get started.
Well, thank you very much. I think Wayne should put on the slides, and then I try to take over your screen, Wayne. That looks amazing. So let me... Okay. All right. Can everybody see the screen? Can you see it? Perfect. All right. Well, first of all, thanks, Madeline, for that great introduction. I have the great honor today to represent Carnoty 3D. What are we? What do we do? We are a machine maker for laser powder bed fusion systems, or in short, 3D printing for metals, so to say. And today, as Madeline pointed out, we want to talk a little bit about how to evolve process control. Wine, I cannot control. There it is. Sorry. Oh. So today we want to talk a little bit about the progress and current challenges for online process monitoring in the field of laser powder bed fusion. And as you've all noticed, this is part of a 3D Natives webinar, and we are really happy to be part of it. Also together with Wayne from Xarion, who will bring us some insights on his acoustic microphone and integration into those flexible machines. Well, for those who don't know us, what do we do? Well, we cover the complete support for customers who want to get involved in additive manufacturing. So we start from consulting, in which we try to elaborate business cases together with our customers. So we basically join them from the beginning. Then we can also offer job shop, material distribution, and run feasibility studies within our testing facilities. That all is enabled by our flexible systems, which is our main business activity. We conceive ourselves as tool machine manufacturer for flexible laser powder bed fusion systems. Maybe unique about Aconity 3D is the fact that everybody, you also can log on to our webpage, which is new by the way, www.aconity3d.com, and you can actually go there and configure your machine according to your specific needs. So you can probably imagine that a machine for a dental restoration framework might look a little bit different than a machine which is well designed for automotive. So some parts, I don't know if you see my mouse, I hope so. So some parts to consider are maybe implication or implementation of preheating for your even heated support structure. Then also what you can have process chambers, which can facilitate faster material change and therefore yield faster productivity or higher productivity, but also you can choose between different lasers, different amount of lasers, different numbers of lasers, and most important for today's webinar is the choice, the option of pyrometry, high-speed camera, or even further inline process monitoring, which I will cover later on. Everything is held together by our web-based machine control software called Aconity Studio. So here are our four basic machines. Aconity Mini is our entry-level system at the right-hand side. Then there's the Aconity MIDI and the MIDI Plus, which both provide exchangeable process chambers, which can then be used for parallelized setup times. And here on the left-hand side in a four-laser configuration is our full-flagged production system, the Aconity One. Well, bringing us to the topic of today's talk is process monitoring. Why is process monitoring important? Well, we tried hard and it was really difficult to get a job which didn't work out within our systems. And you see a picture of that on the right-hand side. So please memorize that picture because we will come to that later on in the talk again. But what are typical reasons for build failure? Well, there could be delamination. So you see that here at the tip of those triangles a little bit and here at the core of that rectangular structure, part of your build job just moved upwards and therefore might cause a collision with the recoder. Also, you might have overheating, which is always bad news because you might change the history, the thermal history of your build part, which has influence on your microstructure. Then you might have an uneven powder deposition or have a wrong focal plane or a completely wrong machine setup. And last but not least, and most likely the most common reason for bad jobs is a bad design of your build jobs. So process monitoring altogether is crucial for high quality, truly industrialized builds. At this, we at Aconity distinguish between two different ways of process monitoring. One is on-axis process monitoring and the other is off-axis process monitoring. So to cover on-axis process monitoring first, I brought this little schematic which you see on the right-hand side. So on-axis process monitoring for us always means that we have this schematic process monitoring box here. In reality, it's a little bit more complex, of course, but that allows us to be coaxially with our laser and always take information from the interaction zone. So here we have mostly optical sensors as we apply our optical tool, which is the scan head itself. So we might have pyrometry, high speed camera, or optical coherence tomography, in short OCT. So this allows you to distract local information directly from the laser material interaction zone. And here I brought some examples for that. So on the right hand side, you see actually a video, which typically should run a little bit smoother, so this is due to zoom, but where you have the laser spot in the middle and you see the region of interest moves along with the laser spot. So we always take the information from where it is actually happening. So what you see here, we have a modulated laser beam. You don't see it too much because it's not a smooth video here. I'm sorry for that. But you see that those melt dots don't touch each other. And we see the same information on the left-hand side on our what we call emission map. That emission map is generated with our pyrometry. And as we know the exact location X and Y of our scan head. In each and every milli microsecond of the process, we are able to calculate such emission map. So now what you can do with the pyrometry on the left-hand side and the high-speed camera on the right-hand side, you can actually react to bad process parameters within the job. So you can actually stand next to the machine, see, okay, that doesn't look all right. We need to change parameters. And the camera on the right-hand side is a great tool here to gather information from the process you wouldn't know in any other way. And also maybe ground simulations closer to reality. What we also see is how powder is sucked into the interaction zone. This is called the chimney effect. So all that is stuff that was not known to the industry before tools like that existed. However, on the left-hand side, we also see the impact of the better parameter set, so to say, on our emission reading. And that's the beauty of it. So the high-speed camera allows to detect basic information, whereas the pyrometry might, at least in theory, be used for process control, a topic we will cover later on. So what you can do with the pyrometry here, as an example for a triangle, we started with the first scan track on the left-hand side. So this is a little bit colder, bluer, and you see as we progress within the part, our scan vectors become shorter and shorter. And that translates into an intrinsic preheating effect, so to say. So that's common, that's state of the art in additive manufacturing, especially laser powder bed fusion. So what you have here, a constant laser power, and depending on your scan vector length, the shorter the scan vector length, the more pronounced is the overheating. And that's obviously bad news, because first of all, you've changed your thermal history of your part, which might have influence on your microstructure. Second of all, if your melt pool is hotter, it's most likely larger. So your tip might be a little bit less tipsy, let's put it that way. So constant laser power here in generally causes overheating. So that's something to take away with you. So what we tried now is to have a correlation between our sensor signal and our process parameters. So what you see in that slide is we have changed our scan speed from 800 to 1200 millimeters per second. And you see that the sensor signal correlates to that. So the emission readings largely depend on our applied parameter set. So that's really, really good news. However, one missing link is there, missing link to reality. And that's what we show in the next picture. And here we see if we have a higher emissivity reading, we can also see that in real life, that translates into a larger heat affected zone. So we can actually see, okay, we have a correlation between sensor signal, applied parameter sets, and real world. And that allows us now to bridge the gap to have a closed loop control, potentially. Let's see later on. However, the question is pyrometry the right sensor? Because what it does, it gathers information on the emissivity, on the emission from the process. So now our idea was, why not combine it with another sensor? So here, one example is an optical coherence tomography, or in short, OCT. This is nothing more than a Michelson interferometry. So what it does is, you have a reference arm length and you have your measuring arm length. So here you see your measuring arm length. This would be your scan head, and you have a slight angle of incidence, and then you scan your part. So normally what you have this bowl effect. So this bowl effect can be corrected for, which we did. However, due to the limitations of our reference arm, we have a slightly decreased build area of 40 millimeters in radius, which we can cover with that sensor. However, work is on the way to improve that. However, once we combine those two sensors, we can get added information. First of all, here, just the OCT sensor, we see actually a reading of the powder deposition. Really, really finely, we can see how well the powder is deployed. But a little bit more interesting maybe is combination of pyrometry and OCT sensor. So what you see in this little bridge, and please also memorize that one because we will come across that one later on as well. You see the colors are deducted from the pyrometry, translating into an emissivity reading. And the Z information comes from the OCT sensor. So what we see here for the first layer, which is actually built on a bare powder layer, you see that the penetration depth is a lot larger and we have a less defined surface here, which is common to the process. Also, we see there's something going on here. There are certain defects within the part. So that can be well detected with our inline process monitoring tools. So that brings us to the second choice of monitoring tools, being off-axis monitoring. So off-axis is typically placed somewhere, but not within the scan head. So here as an example, we have a thermal camera, which is placed on our machine cover, which covers the whole region of interest, being the build plate itself. So we call it global sensors. Here we have optical sensors, like thermal camera, shown here. We have optical tomography. I will cover that later on. And we have visual imaging, which is nothing more than a high power webcam, so to say. And last but not least, and I'm really, really happy that we have Wayne here today talking about acoustic sensors like the optical microphone, which we also implemented into our machine. So global information can be deducted from the entire build chamber by applying these sensors. So first example, and I'm really happy about that one, is thermal imaging. So we have a thermal camera which records in certain wavelengths, which translates to, to a certain temperature region of up to 2000 centigrades. So what you can do actually is you can not only record that, but in the Urbis professional software, which is provided by Infratech, the provider of the camera, you can actually choose little areas of interest and you can get a reading of the temperature over that area of interest. And everything like that can be done after the process. So you get a strong tool for post-process analysis. Even nicer maybe is this little slide. Let's start both equally. Oh, that one didn't start. Okay, remote doesn't work like it should be. But it's the same video taken from the same process in the same layer. However, what we did afterwards, we just changed the region of interest in terms of the temperature. So here you have a temperature up to 2000 centigrade. On the right-hand side, more to 300 centigrade. So the reason behind that is, on the left-hand side, you can see what is the thermal history, what is the real thermal history, so to say. While on the right-hand side, you can see where is sputtering taking place. And here you see there's a lot of spreading. There's like fireworks. And if you remember right, that is the exact job I showed at the beginning, which didn't work out. And now we see why. Because there's a lot of spattering. There's too much energy within the process, and that actually caused delamination. So you can, with the tools provided here, highlight different temperature scales and actually analyze your jobs at a later state. Next slide. Give me a second. Here it is the optical tomography. So what we do here, we have a sensor which is attached at the optical bench, and it's actually a line camera. And what we do here, we take a look at a 120 millimeter region of interest, which translates to something like 22 micron per pixel. So we have a really high detailed picture of our build chamber. And what we do with that sensor, we have a long-term exposure, similar as if you take pictures of the stars at night. You just open up your shutter of your camera and you get all the light from the galaxy, so to say. So here, less interesting, it's not the galaxy, but it's at least a laser process. We can record the thermal history of printed parts. And here we see what our partner at RWTH Aachen, which is a digital additive production chair, did with that sensor on an Econity MIDI Plus. You see a recording on the left-hand side from 600 to 1,200 centigrades. And you can actually increase the bottom threshold from 720 to 1,200. So you have a more pronounced, detailed view on the thermal history of your part. And you can actually see a little bit at the bottom here that the direction of your fume extraction has an influence on the thermal history of your parts. And that's really interesting, and that's really handy if you want to work on the process, if you want to push the boundaries and the current state of the art. Well, last but not least, we have our WIS imaging. So that is basically, like I said, a webcam. So you can actually use it nowadays for home office. Take a look at the process and take a look if it works out well. So what you see here on the right-hand side, however, that is what we call history snapshots. So we have also a function at which we take pictures at the end of each layer. And that leaves you with, a lot of pictures after the job, a couple of thousand, which can easily be implemented into a video, what we see right here, which is a really nice, straightforward tool for first investigation, whether or not there are any obvious flaws within your process. And that helps a lot towards increasing quality for your industrially applied parts. So that's all from my side. I'd like to hand over to my colleague Ryan, and I'm really excited about what you have to tell.
Thank you, Yves. Let me take control back of the screen. Okay, there we go. So thanks for the introduction and for the opportunity to introduce you to another type of off-axis process monitoring using an optical microphone. So it turns out that the laser material processes don't only emit a lot of light, which you can use in many ways, as Yves has shown us, but also emit a lot of ultrasound. And this is what we are picking up with the optical microphone. So what I'm going to discuss is really the air-coupled acoustic emission, so not structure-borne, but really the sound waves coming directly from the process zone through air into our sensor, the optical microphone. Let me give you just a really short background on the company Xarion. We are the manufacturers of this unique optical microphone, and we have our primary markets really in non-destructive testing and in process monitoring. We are a company that was founded 9 years ago. We're about 31 people, mostly engineers, physicists, laser physicists, and we've been working with Aconity on the laser powder bed fusion process and monitoring of it in acoustic means since 2018. So what is an optical microphone? Why is it called optical microphone? This is due to the principle of operation. What we are exploiting is the fact that sound pressure actually affects the speed of light. So our setup is shown on the right side. You can actually also see a little image of the sensor head itself. It's a very small, compact sensor. And at the tip of this sensor is essentially a small interferometer, which is open to the surrounding air. And now when the sound wave passes through, it is affecting the laser beam that is bouncing there back and forth. And that is changing the light intensity. And that is what we are measuring. So it's a microphone, but without a membrane. So it's the first microphone based on an akinetic principle, a principle without any moving elements. That gives us unique features in terms of picking up high frequencies. It gives us an immense bandwidth. So to give you an idea, the human ear can pick up sounds up to 20 kilohertz. With the optical microphone, we can reach 50 times higher, so up to 1 megahertz. And that is still 10 times more than you would be able to pick up with a conventional microphone. So in a laser process, you have acoustic emission in air, and with a conventional microphone, you would only be able to see a small part of it in the lower frequency ranges, but you would be missing all the high frequency information, which is only accessible if you use a broadband membrane-free sensor like the optical microphone. So this gives us two unique advantages, and these are proprietary to basically the physical principle of ultrasound in air, and I want to just highlight two of them here in the context of laser powder bed fusion. So on the left side is just a short illustration. Essentially, when you analyze high frequency air-coupled ultrasound, you sort of are in a protective bubble, let's say, where you're only measuring the acoustics within this area and not this being disturbed from sounds coming from, let's say, neighboring machine or other sounds within the production hall. So the reason for that is that these sounds at high frequency do not travel so far, so they stay kind of in a defined area. So if you place the sensor in that area, you can be sure only to measure the signal from the process itself. And on the right side is the second advantage of measuring in the high ultrasound frequencies, which is you get a really high temporal resolution. So what you see here is a spectrogram. I'm going to be showing those a couple of times within these slides. So let me just briefly explain. It's a three-dimensional representation of the acoustic signal, representing time, in this case here on the y-axis, frequency on the x-axis, and the amplitude is color-coded. So this is taken from a powder bed fusion process. Starting on the top, you've got your process emission, and at some point the laser turns off. And you can see immediately in the higher frequency ranges, that's also where the process signal stops. Whereas in the low frequencies, you have a lot of reverberation, which can actually smear the signal, so makes it a little bit unclear. So it's really good to have the access to the high frequencies in order to really resolve the acoustic events at a high resolution. So talking about the integration of this sensor in the Aconity machines, we've gone very far steps here already together with Aconity. You can see the sensor head being placed in the build chamber, here in the green circle. It is positioned so that its field of view is spread across the entire scanning area. And also it is being triggered automatically by the Aconity machine. So the data acquisition is triggered either layer by layer or part by part, however it's configured in the end, but also in terms of acquisition, implementation is being carried out. So the data that we receive from the optical microphone is typically first and foremost, a 2D representation. So that's what you see on the top. This is the acoustic raw data. It's the signal amplitude over time. Another way to look at it is, as I mentioned, the spectrogram. So that's below. That gives you the three-dimensional representation. And here we can see that in a powder bed fusion process, we do actually have signal up to 500, 600 kilohertz. And zooming into the actual process signal, so here on section 2, we can even differentiate the individual vectors, also thanks to the bandwidth. So that brings me to the applications. I want to talk about five different applications where the optical microphone can be used. Starting with incorrect powder application. As Yves mentioned, it's of course critical to have an even distribution of the powder across your entire scanning area, across the entire layer. And having troubles with that will result in a bad part quality. So it turns out that the acoustic emission is actually drastically different if you have a powder application or not. So without powder, the acoustic emission is about 28% less than with powder, so as it should be. And that we have seen in a comparison with optical sensors is actually more significant. So this kind of defect comes out very strongly on the acoustic side. So it's possible to, in this way, indicate whether parts are laid bare or are maybe pulled up due to some deformation happening, something like that. So incorrect powder application is something that can be heard, so to speak. Another nice application is the detection of spatters or melt pool ejections. This is, of course, unwanted to have spattering because they can lie on an area which is later on being lasered, and it can cause difficulties in the part at that point. So that should be avoided. And it turns out that this spattering event or this melt pool ejection goes with a broadband acoustic signature. And we've correlated that here just using a webcam. So we do want to do some investigation using high-speed camera, but we also know from laser welding applications, which we are also very active in, that these spatterings can be heard in the high ultrasound frequencies. So spattering is another application. Of course, very suitable for acoustics is crack detection. Of course, cracks are a dramatic decrease in the part durability. So also they should be avoided, and they can happen if the metals or the composition of base plate and powder is not the same, or if there's some thermal stresses. So these should be avoided, and it should be detected very quickly. You do not want to have hours of building and realize that everything is cracked. So it should be detected as soon as possible. So very often these cracks form after the exposure time in the cool down phase. And they are represented by a also broadband short spike, and can be easily detected that way because there is not a lot of background noise. And I want to point out again, we are measuring essentially on top of the powder bed. So we're measuring the air-coupled acoustic emission, not structure-borne, but really the air-coupled one. So we're looking at cracks from the surface, from subsurface, depending on the amplitude of the cracking. And we're able to maintain a constant acoustic path. So because in terms of maybe structure-borne acoustic emissions, you do have changing in the acoustic path length as you go on and build your part. Since we are positioned on top of the powder bed, we have always the same distance to the source, let's say. And cracks are a difficult thing to see for optical sensors because they do not emit any form of light. So that's really suitable for an acoustics sensor. I have here a short video. It actually shows you also the display of the real-time spectrogram. This is what you see when you have the optical microphone installed in the chamber with our measurement computer. It records 30,000 spectra per second all the way up to 1 megahertz. So it really gives you an in-depth and real-time look into the acoustic fingerprint. And again, here you can see the individual layers. That's kind of this pattern. The individual vectors, that is this pattern, and frequencies up to 400, 500 kilohertz. So when I play the video, you can see different parts being built in the chamber, then the signal stops, and then we have this broadband crack. Next up, we have this just recoder signal. It's actually in the lower frequencies, and then again, a crack signal. So process stops, a crack appears here, and we've got a recoder signal, which is kind of a recurring signal, and then in this case, another crack. So that gives you a really good look into the real-time acoustic signature. As we can see in the video, also the recoder is something that produces acoustics, and we can use it. We can assess that acoustic information as well, especially if the process or the part, for whichever reason, starts to deform, possibly due to cracks, prior cracks. and the recorder is then scratching across the part. That produces also a significant signal, which we can use and output a warning monitor this deviation. Also, we can use the regular recoder signal for predictive maintenance use. So we are not only, maybe it's good to point it out here, we're not only active, let's say, whilst the laser is doing its job, but actually during also phases before and after. Final application I want to show you is the focus detection. Imagine lines being drawn at different focus height, and then it turns out that the acoustic amplitude, the curve of the acoustic amplitude, is symmetric around the ideal focus. So if you run through a negative focus position all the way through the zero focus up to a positive focus, you will see a kind of Lorentz curve, most likely. And then at the symmetry point, that's where you know you are in the right focus. And of course, being in the correct focus is absolutely essential to control the process. And in many cases, people look at the sample, they maybe do a test scan on a plate and look at the sample. And we've seen many times that the acoustic signal gives actually an easier and clearer view of where the focus position would be, where sometimes with the eye, it can be quite hard to tell.
Sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to notice we're running out of time. So if we could start wrapping up, that would be good.
Okay, I'm going to speed up. That was already the last application. I want to leave you with an outlook of what's coming up very soon. So we have a dashboard on the development, which will show you not only the spectrogram and the raw data, which I've showed previously, but also really the spatial distribution of the acoustic signal in the scanning area. That enables you to select a certain area, a certain part, and then showcase you the corresponding spectrogram. And of course, if something is going wrong, if, for example, a crack has occurred at a certain time, this will be highlighted through this dashboard. With this, I want to give you a short detour to showcase what we are all about at Xarion. So we have microphones, for example, at CERN, Large Hadron Collider, Particle Collider in Switzerland. And there we are measuring proton impacts on collimator jaws in extremely high radioactive fields, electromagnetic fields. So we're not afraid of these kind of acoustic applications. And I think it's safe to say we are really experts in cutting edge acoustic applications. So summing up, I'm going to give you the screen in a second. You can use the microphone in a pre-process phase for checking focus position, during the process for checking spatters, checking optimal powder application, and in post-process for detecting cracks and doing predictive maintenance. So thanks for your attention. I'm going to hand back over to Yves. Yes. If you have the control.
Thank you. So thanks. Okay. Thanks, Vaim, for these really interesting inputs. So now I want to give a brief wrap up about what to do with all of that. And thank you also for the many, many questions, which we will cover later on in like 2 to 5 minutes. So bear a second with me. But process monitoring is one thing. It's really, really important. It's important to take a look at your process. It's important to understand what's going on. But the holy grail, at least to my humble opinion, is process control. So we at Econity want to make sure that even if you kick your machine, you have a high quality part. So for this, at Econity, we distinguish between three different times. So one is the less interesting, which we skip for today, in between jobs. Take out a part, take a look at it. If it's not good, build it again. Well, we've all done that. We've all been there. Takes a lot of time and effort. No fun. So in the middle, what we have is layer to layer process control. This is potentially really interesting because it gives you at least a little bit of calculation time doing powder deposition, right? But then the pinnacle, so to say, of process control is in layer or maybe even in vector or in micro vector process control. And let's take a look at where we are currently and where we want to be in really, really short future. So first of all, let's talk about layer to layer process control. And we actually got many, many questions about the emissivity, and all of these questions are exactly right, because they claimed, well, emissivity is a function of temperature and material, right? So how do you make sure that the temperature you record is correct? Well, that's easy to answer. We don't. We are just interested in the relative signal, and the relative signal you see here if scanned from left to right is that the shorter the scan vectors, the more pronounced overheating is. We don't care about the true temperature because we don't have an equilibrium process here anyhow. However, what you can do now, and that's from a control point of view, no rocket science, is take all these areas and reduce the laser power. And we've done so actually already in 2016. So you see, if you now reduce your laser power according to your scan vector length, you can achieve having a homogeneous temperature distribution. So for those of you who are real expert and paid close attention, you have noticed that in both examples, we scanned from left to right. So typically in LPBF, that's not the case. Typically you rotate in each and every layer. And that's one of the major drawbacks in layer to layer process control, in my humble opinion, because you cannot rely on the information of your preceding layer, because something might change in your geometry and also your orientation might change. Anyhow, we took this information to implement within our software the possibility to have such dynamic power control. So you as a customer get to choose low laser powers for shorter scan vector lengths, higher laser power for higher scan vector lengths to account for that issue. That brings us to in-layer process control. So what you have to do here, we developed a specific high-speed controller for that. And we gave it a wedding partner, so to say, which is a Python interface, which allows you to choose different controlling values, namely PID, which is proportional, integral, and differential. And if you do so, you can easily integrate that into all of our Econity machines due to the open machine architecture. And well, for those of you who have paid attention, you've seen the left-hand bridge. So now what you see for non-controlled bridge, we see a little bit fuzzy different colors, and we see there are defects in the front. Then if we apply a p-value, we see the temperature distribution means emissivity is a lot more homogeneous and less pronounced defect here. If we add a little spice or i-value to the controller, we get an even more homogenized reading of our bridge. So defects can be reduced by appropriate power control. So that brings me to the second last slide. So what you see here is actually a reading during the process in terms of emissivity. And here in gray is actually the laser power rectangular, which we applied. And if we apply that, we get a reading which is shown in green. And actually we get the reading from each and every vector, which is why that's a zigzag line, so to say, right? So the non-controlled process shows this high reading in green and then goes, here's a new part, shorter part, higher reading, the shorter different readings. So what we did here now, we applied an in-vector power control. So that's the dashed or blue line zigzag line. And no, the red zigzag line, sorry. And the resulting reading from that emissivity-wise is the blue line. So we see with our power control, we can actually achieve in having a lot more robust process. And we can see actually that we can control the laser in regards to the emission signal. So the question after all is pyrometry the right sensor for that? And that's why we spend so much time in the beginning talking about process monitoring. Is maybe acoustic signals the right sensor for that? However, what we achieved in doing is actually building those bridges. On the top, you see there's a non-controlled bridge. You see those typical defects, because even though people claim with additive manufacturing you can print every geometry, well, on easy bridges sometimes you have issues because there's a so-called overhang. So what we did here with the power controlled part, we see we have drastically improved the quality, the roughness, and decreased the distortion for critical geometries. However, it's really crucial to take home three main aspects. Power control in process depends on three main issues. One is machine configuration. Second is the material itself. Third is the applied process parameters.
Sorry to interrupt. I just want to, yes. Let's wrap up some of the last ideas so we can move to the Q&A.
Thank you. So we are at Econity. We don't believe in determining which machine configuration to use. So that is flexible. We don't determine which material to use. That is flexible. And we want to encourage you as a customer to use different parameter sets. So for us, this becomes a product once the customer gets to choose the PID values itself. And we believe we are there in May. So let's wrap up, brief conclusion. AMF metal, full potential, not yet reached, I believe, but we are constantly working on it and working towards pushing the boundaries. Sensor implementation, within Econity machines, you can implement extended sensor range and different choices. For process monitoring, we showed extended capabilities for either on or off axis error detection, depending on what you're looking for as a customer. And last but not least, process control. We've shown a first application. And of course, there will be a lot more work to come. And that's it from my side. Sorry for taking a little bit more of your time. But now we are really happy to answer some of your questions.
Great. Well, that's what I come back in. So thank you, everyone. I see we have quite a few questions. If it's all right with everyone, we will probably run a little late, 5 to 10 minutes, just so we can try and answer as many questions as possible. Of course, if you need to leave, go ahead. Just this way we can get to more of you. So starting with the first question. So one of the first questions we got was from an anonymous attendee who would like to know, can you detect plasma signal and does it interfere with the measurement?
Very clear, yes. Plasma has a certain wavelength in which it emits. However, depending on what wavelength you are listening to, you can actually cut it out or not. So if you're interested in plasma, there are sensors which are really capable of detecting plasma. So it is capable to take a look at plasma, yes.
Great. Another question. Since emissivity is the property of material which ranges between 0 and 1, how are your emissivity values so high? Are you sure that's what you're measuring? How are you converting the pyrometry measurements into a temperature?
Absolutely. So that's what I tried to point out. Also with the thermal camera, you've seen two videos being the same videos, actually. What we've just done later on within the software is changing the emissivity, which gives you a different temperature reading then. And the same holds for our pyrometries. Of course, we choose a certain emissivity from which we believe is right. However, powder has a different emissivity than bulk metal. Plasma has a different emissivity. Melpool has a different emissivity. So emissivity readings is really, really difficult. Or long-term, short-term temperature readings in this speed is really difficult because it's contactless, 2 meters per second. So we concentrate on relative readings. We say, okay, we have a golden part. We have one parameter set from which we know it works great. And from that reading, we can compare that reading of the golden part, so to say, to the readings we got at a later stage from our following part. And that's sufficient to say, well, we should have a high quality part.
Okay, well, another question is, adaptive laser power control based on the characteristics of the previously built layer is a good approach. What if the previously built layer has more defects?
Let me read the question, adaptive laser control, please. Yes, so that's the problem. That's what I tried to point out. That's the problem in layer-to-layer process control. You cannot rely on the information you get. So if you have defects on your previous layer, and then you start controlling based on the defects, then of course you will get overall really, really bad results. So that has to be taken into account, of course, with all the parameters. That's why we at Econity believe that we want to provide the tool to do so to our customers. We want our customers to play around. We are not here. We are too small of a company to claim we have the solution to everything, but we are quite well in providing tool machines which allow our valued customers to tackle exactly these really relevant questions.
Okay. So another anonymous attendee has asked, if I understood correctly, the OT camera is a line camera. How does it create a 2D image? Does it require an additional scanner?
No, it's that OT was off axis, so it was just placed with a certain region of interest. Honestly, I'm not sure if it was a line camera. I might be mistaken. I just get a no. So it's not a line camera. There was wrong information from my side. Sorry. But what's important to take away, it's a long exposure time. So it's basically a certain special camera which has 22 pixels per millimeter, 22 microns per pixel. Sorry. So you have a high resolution for long time exposure, which then can be translated into a thermal emissivity or temperature if you know the emissivity.
Okay, we have a question now for Ryan. Are you able to distinguish between the acoustic signals of parallel working lasers?
That's a good question. So far, we've looked at single laser situations. Multi-laser, I think we will have to look at as a next step. I do believe that using, again, the high bandwidth and again the properties of being able to look at a certain location, we may be able to differentiate whether the laser or whether the signal is coming from a certain location within the build chamber.
Plus, Ryan, we can always modulate. Sorry for interrupting. We can modulate a laser, right? So, yeah. So you can listen to a certain modulation. You can modulate it so fast that it doesn't have any influence on the process, but still can be determined by Ryan's technology.
That's true, and I think also things like then a little bit depends probably on the parameter you want to monitor. But for example, cracks for sure is something that's kind of disattached from how many lasers you're using. You might get a crack if you're losing multiple lasers or a single laser. In any case, you will get a strong acoustic signal. So that's something I think we could definitely also see in multi-laser.
Well, actually, that brings me to, well, there are two questions from Lucas. One is, are you able to see cracking during laser illumination? And the other is, why are high frequencies emitted in general in LPBF? And why are there more with powder than without powder?
So we are able to see cracking also during the exposure time. Then, of course, we do have also the process emission. So then it depends a little bit on the amplitude of the crack, if it sort of sticks out, obviously. but we have seen that as well to be able to, yeah, to detect that. And the second question regarding why is it broadband in anyway? Well, it's broadband because it's happening at a very short time scale. So if you have a metal melting and evaporating, that is creating a shock wave in air, and the rise time of that pressure amplitude is very short, so on the microseconds scale, and that gives us then through the Fourier transform the high frequencies.
Okay, I'm going to skip around a tiny bit just so that we mixed up a little bit. Another question from an anonymous attendee was, if you control within the vector, what is your sample rate and reaction rise full time of your laser?
Well, it depends a little bit on the laser manufacturer. So certain laser manufacturers claim 50 kilohertz. Others claim 100 kilohertz. So we've seen readings from the laser concerning the waves and fall time, and it is definitely a lot faster than any frequency you would see doing the process. So these are typically at 5 kilohertz. That should typically be enough to do manipulation doing the process in each and every vector.
Okay, and then another question is, are all these sensors and process control already commercially available? Can you find them in machines already?
Yes, well, Aconity is a special machine manufacturer. So those are the sensors we have already implemented into our machine. So those are for us more or less standard sensors. So these are commercially available. What is an outlook as of today is the process control with our eCam hardware, so to say. So that allows us then to react within a vector, and that will become a commercially available product once we succeeded in providing the controlling parameters, namely PID, as a standard process parameter, so to say. So for us, customers shouldn't be bothered with laser power of 200 watts anymore. It should be, okay, that's my standard laser power, and I have these control values, so I make sure everything works well. And that's our vision, so to say.
Okay. Well, continuing to jump around a tiny bit. So another autonomous attendee has asked, is there any overlapping in the failure mechanisms, or does each mechanism belong to a specific bandwidth?
Well,
is that addressed on the acoustics?
Yeah, the acoustics has a different bandwidth than all the optical. So they're each, I just answer from the optical standpoint, Ryan, sorry. Okay. So with optical sensors, they rely on a spectral separation of different wavelengths. So pyrometries measure in different wavelengths than your visual camera, of course. And then, Ryan, you, of course, have even higher potential.
Well, yeah, but we're looking at a completely, let's say, different physical property. So I think it's nice to probably also just combine various sensors with each other to kind of cross-check. But in terms of acoustics, the defects depends on what kind of defect it is or what kind of parameter are very often broadband, but sometimes we've seen if a pulsed laser is used, then you can also have some tonal components or specific frequencies. And then you can also set the filter around those frequencies and only look at, let's say, the acoustic energy in that frequency band.
Okay, well, another question from an anonymous attendee is, even though you are not converting emissance measurements into an actual temperature, can you comment on how tightly you can control melt pool temperature in closed loop control versus open loop control? In other words, in closed loop control, what is the bandwidth of your temperature measurement?
Excellent question. And we have measured it. Our parameters, we always use two parameters in order to have the two color parameter option as well. Question is, do you trust your non-tactical temperature measurements? And honestly speaking, I don't. And that's not because of us. It's because, we have a dynamic process. It's not an equilibrium process. We have part of the melt pool is still mushy. The other part is solidified. So long story short, within our sensors, we get plus minus 10 centigrades or Kelvin. However, what's that worth? Because it's really, really difficult to ground that in real world. However, it also correlates to simulations we have done so far. But typically, we don't talk about temperatures because, temperature is solidifying temperature is just one temperature, right? But you have a whole temperature region for your melt pool. And the question here is, what is the right temperature? I don't know. I just know that we have good quality parts, good quality prints, and we have a correlating sensor signal to that. And to cover the question of Marie Fischer as well, asking actually if what is the controlling based on? That's exactly what the controlling is based on. We want to put in standard parameters and then just have the controller make sure that we meet those standard parameters in the sensor signal. So it's a relative controlling towards a moving target, so to say.
Okay, great. We've actually answered quite a lot of questions. So a few more before we end is, another one for Zarian, so Ryan, are you able to distinguish between the acoustics? Oh no, we already asked this, sorry. Will the acoustic signal amplitude, will it vary with the noise generated by the laser irradiation of the powder bed?
Will it vary with the irradiation of the powder bed? Yes. For example, we see also, for instance, the directions of the laser in the powder. However, we do believe that we are actually getting a more, let's say, or less diminished energy from the process zone than with an optical sensor. Of course, we claim that because we do not have so much obstruction due to the, let's say, fume that builds on top of the process. Essentially, ideally, the acoustic signal should stay sort of as stable as possible and also not fluctuate too much, not have too many broadband outliers, because that typically signals that something has happened. And homogeneous acoustic signal typically signals also that your process is running stable.
Okay, great. So I just looked at the time, so I think we can probably answer one last question and then wrap up. The question will be the first one we get. How do you decide on laser power based on the melting point of the metal? Is there any direct relation to calculate the laser power?
Yeah, and exactly. And that's the missing gap. That's the missing information, so to say. So honestly, I don't know which laser power to use to get a certain temperature. And more importantly, I don't know which temperature is the right temperature to process steel. And also, I don't believe there's one distinguished temperature which is the right temperature for your steel, right? So I believe this is such a dynamic process. And thermal equations, well, they are dynamic equations as well, right? So we just want to make sure that we have relative signals. So the missing gap here is actually what I try to show. Is there a correlation between the sensor signal and your parameters? If so, is there a correlation between the real world? And we showed, yes, there is. However, that is different for each and every material and for each and every parameter set. So you can have two different parameter sets which are equally dense. However, you get completely different emissivity signals. And that's the task here at hand, so to say. And we provide the tools. The task is making sure that the controller works for my part in question.
Okay, great. Well then, let's wrap up. Gentlemen, do you have any last words to say to our remaining audience?
Ryan, maybe you start.
Thanks a lot for the interesting questions. And thanks for the opportunity to speak, and thank you for listening from my side.
Yeah. Also, thank you, Ryan. Thank you, Madeline. Also, thank you for these great questions. In case you have any further questions later on, feel free just to contact us, right? My contact information is down here on the slide. Same holds for Ryan. So, yeah, we are eager to learn more about your challenges and to push the boundaries of additive manufacturing together and find out what great other applications could be around the corner, just waiting to make them reality. So, thank you for all your attention, and have a great day.
Great. Well, there you have it, everyone. If you have any further questions, don't hesitate to reach out to Akanti or to Zarian with Ryan. And then I will just say my last bit, which is thank you very much for attending today. We usually have webinars every single month, so do keep an eye out for our next webinar, which should be coming up. And I hope you all have a wonderful afternoon, evening, morning, depending on where you're based. We have quite an international audience, so I don't know. And okay, have a great day. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.